Well, praise the Lord. Turn to someone and tell them, you look good. Can you turn to someone and tell them, hey, you look so good, I want to keep praising God beside you. Tell them, you make me look good when I praise God. Have you ever been in an atmosphere where everything just feels right? This is a church where everything feels just right. I'm so glad to be here. I count it a privilege to be here at home. I'll say it again, here at home. You know, every time I come here, I feel at home. I mean, they give me some nice tea, coffee, they give me all type of stuff back there. I'm like, man, this, us Mexicans can eat, but man. I'm so grateful for Pastor Jerry, for Pastor Jackie's invitation. To be honest with you, every time I come here, it's a reality for me. I feel at home. And not because it's just life to the world, but because Jesus is here. And you could just tell when Jesus is here. Amen? Why don't we do something? Why don't we just lift our hands up right now and just close our eyes and say, Lord, thank you. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be here. There's so many people that couldn't make it. Some of them went to be home with you, Lord. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to live now. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to be in your presence. There's no better place. We're so happy. We're so alive when we're here. We belong here. This is home. You prepared a place for us. You prepared a table for us that, so that we can eat of your goodness. We're so grateful for that. Lord, we pray that your word will be clear. We pray that your word will be understandable and practical in our lives. Holy Spirit, have your way today. Have your way. We love you so much. We dare not be in your presence and not be able to receive of you. We hunger for your presence this morning. Come on, can you just give God 10 seconds of worship right there where you're at? Say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. His Holy Spirit that abides in us. You may be seated, please. So excited. I bring greetings from my wife Martha. Pastor Jackie said, man, I was wishing she was here. And, well, you know how that goes. Pastor Abel has to leave. Pastor Martha takes over. And I'm just grateful to be married to a woman of God who loves Jesus. And man, we're just blessed. Pastor Jerry is one of the most blessed men I know. Every time we get together, we have fun, we go out to eat, we laugh together, we talk about you guys. In a good way. You know, we love to fellowship because I believe that that's what the word means. When we come together, we are one with Jesus Christ as we come together. It doesn't matter if we're in church or we're at a restaurant eating. We not to forget that Jesus is Lord in our life. So today I want to share with you something that I did not know, and I'm grateful because I'm grateful that it's the Lord. I want you to go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16. And I want to take some time, if I could say this, to set up a platform for next Sunday. I really don't know what the bishop is going to preach about, but I believe he's going to preach about the Bible. And so as long as he's in the Bible, we're all okay, right? So 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16 is where I would be. For who can know the Lord's thoughts? Who knows enough to teach him? But we understand these things. For we have the mind of Christ. I'm going to read the last part. For we have the mind of Christ. I want you to turn to three people, tell them you're Christ-minded. Now, I just want to now tell somebody they're going to brainwash you today. How many of you know we need to be brainwashed sometimes? We need to get some stuff out from the world that doesn't bring any good fruit in our lives. So somebody tells you, hey, they brainwash you there at Light of the World. You tell them, yes, that's true. They do brainwash me. They take all the carnal mentality out of me and put Jesus in me. So, yeah, it makes sense. Somebody say it makes sense. The Apostle Paul spent some time speaking to the church in Corinthians. Now, you have to understand something about the church in Corinthians. The church in Corinthians had all the gifts of the Spirit. I mean, they were one of the most filled spiritually church that you could ever find in those times. All the gifts of the Spirit were moving. You would see miracles. You would see wonders. You would see signs. But the church in Corinthians had a problem. They were very carnal minded. You can have so many gifts, but gifts are given by grace. To be Christ-minded is to be formed in His image. To understand in reality why He lives in your heart. That can only be done through the Holy Spirit. You see, Paul knew that the Corinthians had character issues. They knew that if the church was going to make a big impact in the world, they would have to be Christ-minded. They would have to understand what it meant to be in the right mindset. Most churches today are not in the right mindset. They build their own kingdoms. They worry more about their own logo than the cross. They worry more about their name than the name that is above all names, which is Jesus. That is the reality that we live in today. We live in a society, and when I speak society, I'm speaking about the church. We live in a society where everything is permitted and holiness is something that cannot be taught on the pulpit because people will leave. So we have this feel-good church, the church that doesn't have a character. So we have to walk on eggshells to be able to teach. But this isn't happening in Light of the World. I want you to understand something. You're in a ministry that is going to change the world. You're in a ministry that's called Jesus. And our job is not to be social. Our job is to shine Jesus to the nations. And sometimes when we're Christ-minded, it doesn't fit with the way the world thinks. Because their mentality is very, 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 very different. When we went through the pandemic, a lot of churches disappeared. And it was hard. I even had friends that had to close out their churches. Not because they wanted to, but because a lot of people didn't come back to church. They were afraid. The pandemic came to reveal people's hearts in Christ. The people who were not Christ-minded hid from the pandemic. The people who were Christ-minded believed and hid in Jesus. Now I'm going to say that again. We were never in a pandemic. We were in Christ Jesus. Now that's hard to understand when you're not Christ-minded. Paul said one day being in prison, he says, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus. He understood that circumstance was not his prison. He knew that Jesus was his prison. So when you're Christ-minded, you do not let the influence of the world change your principles and the values of your Christian life. When you're Christ-minded, this does not come and destroys your faith. What it does, it reveals Jesus in your heart. You see, a lot of people don't understand, but when you get sick, it's just a part of your life where Jesus will be revealed as your healer. I'll say it again. Because you see, when people get sick, the first thing they do is they worry. Turn to someone and tell them, don't worry. It's just an opportunity for the healing Jesus to show up in your body. Now see, that doesn't get a big hallelujah out of most people, because what happens is we're so, how could I put this? Egocentric. We forget that the person who lives in us is Jesus. He's the center of everything we do. And if the first thing that happens in your life when you wake up in the morning is worry about money, is worry about work, is worry about problems, then Jesus is not the center of your mind. Now, why am I saying this? Because when we are not Christ-minded, the problems that we battle in our mind are stronger. Because we begin to be this Christian Philly church where everything's in emotion. And there are certain things that you don't have to feel. You just know. You see, Jesus said one day, I know where I come from and I know where I'm going. And when he was born on this earth, he went through emotions. He was tired. He was hungry. But he knew his mission. Because in his mind was, I came to do the will of the Father. The funny thing is, he had 12 disciples, and in these 12 disciples, there was one guy named Judas. And he never stopped to take care of Judas. Because he knew Judas had a prophecy in his life. You see, sometimes we run away from a fight. And we have to understand that Judas was in prophecy. He was sent to Jesus' life because he had to fulfill a prophecy. That prophecy was, without a Judas, there was no cross. So you have to understand, even your enemies will be used by God to take you to your destiny. I don't think anybody heard me this morning. Because see, sometimes we fight against these things, and God is using these things to bring you to a next level in your life. And I'm here to tell you, life of the world, there is a new season coming into your life. And sometimes we say, Father, why don't you just take out that deacon? He gets mad at me all the time I come. He wants me to sit wherever he... And God is using him. Somebody say amen to that one. Can't say the amen to that one. Because you see, we don't want the Judas in our life. But without a Judas, there's no cross. Without a Judas, there's no tomb. Without a Judas, there's no resurrection. Without a Judas, there's no salvation for the world. Turn to someone and tell them, you have to be Christ-minded. If you're carnal-minded, you will see your enemies as something that disturbs your future. And you don't want them in your life. But I'm here to tell you, they're necessary. They help you grow. They help you mature. Hello, somebody. They help you get closer to what God has called you to do. The pandemic did not take God by surprise. It just brought the church to a new level of faith. And the people that do not understand that are still today afraid of dying. And I wonder why they're afraid of dying. Is it that they don't know where they're going to go after they die? You see, we come to Jesus and we say, Lord, give me eternal life. But to have eternal life, turn to someone, tell them, God wants to kill you before you can live with him. We don't want to hear that. We want to hear, Lord, heal me. I don't want to get sick. Lord, bless me. I don't want to be attacked by the enemy. All of these things have a purpose in your life. And when you're Christ-minded, hallelujah, you understand the thoughts of why God is putting you through a process. You understand that that process has a purpose to bring God's goodness out of you. Somebody shout amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 47 to 49. Let me teach you something now. Because Jesus never came to save you from hell. He came to save you from yourself. He came to save you from your mindset. Where did this mindset come from? 1 Corinthians 15, verse 47. Adam, the first man, was made from the dust of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven. Listen to verse 48. Earthly people are like the earthly man. Heavenly people are like the heavenly man. Just as we are now like earthly men, we will someday be like heavenly men. Verse 50. What I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. In other words, Paul is saying there's something that you inherited from Adam that causes you to be limited in your flesh. Paul is saying, you have to understand that the first Adam was made from dust. This isn't the fallen Adam. This is the Adam that has not fallen yet. He's trying to explain to the church the Adam before the falling. He came from what? From dust. Say it with me. He came from dust. In other words, Adam was made with the right elements. Now, let me explain this. Genesis chapter 1, verse 11, 12. Then God said, let the land sprout out with vegetation. Let every sort of seed bearing plant and trees that grow, seeds bearing fruit. These seeds will then produce the kinds of plants and trees from which they came. And that is what happened. Verse 12. And the land, say it with me, the land produced. Say it again, the land what? Produced. So this is God, the creator. He looks at the land. He says, I want you to produce. Now, I want you to understand something. The land didn't say to God, God, I need a seminar. I need a discipleship. Tell me point A, point B, point C. The land never said, Lord, how many days do I have to fast to produce? He was God-minded. Wait a minute, Pastor. So you're saying the land has thoughts? Oh, yeah. The Bible says that the land cries out for its salvation. Hello, somebody. So when God spoke to land, he says, I made you with the purpose to produce. And land said, okay, and produced. Tell someone, what takes you too long to produce? He didn't go to a seminar. He didn't need it. He just did what he heard. So, Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord God formed man from where? Now, please understand what I'm telling you. Man heard something from God and said, I can do this. Then God took the same elements and made man. And when he made man, this is different. Because the Bible says he made him from the dust of the ground. The same ground that was able to produce. He was God-minded. Then it says he breathed the breath of life into man's nostrils. What was the difference between both? In one, God speaks. In the other one, God lives in. You're not understanding what I'm telling you. You see, it's not enough to hear. You have to have the breath of God in you. If you do not have the Spirit of God in you, you will hear other things that the world will tell you. And you will be a person that does not produce what God says you have to produce. Somebody just say amen this morning. You see, I came to teach you something. You were not born in this life to be unproductive. You were born into this life to produce. And God is calling to this church, you will enter a new season to produce. Lift up your hand and say, I'm going to produce. I'm going to multiply. Come on, you got to say that with faith. Say, I'm going to multiply. So, please look at this. God speaks a word to the land, and it produces vegetation. When he speaks to man, he says, I'm not only going to speak to him, I want to live in him. I'm going to make my spirit go into his nostrils. Turn to someone and tell him this. It smells like heaven in this place. You ever go to a room and you say, something smells fishy in here. Where does that come from? You see, when you were made to smell. There's a sense of presence. When you come to church, it's like, it smells like heaven in this place. And then you go to somewhere else and you say, doesn't smell good here. Something's off. You see, being Christ-minded is to be able to discern the different atmospheres. There'll be people in your life that will tell you, why don't you come to this church? You're going to say, that doesn't smell like Jesus. What's all that about tithing at church? That doesn't smell like that's Jesus talking. Hello, somebody. When you're Christ-minded, you can smell the breath of God. You ever carry a newborn baby? You carry, it's got that new car smell, right? New car smell. He starts to grow and all of a sudden he smells like kindergarten. You ever go to school, it smells like school? How many teachers are here? You know what I'm talking about. You go in, you smell all the crayon. You smell all. That's, God wants to take the church to be able to discern atmospheres. Hallelujah. Peter told Jesus, Jesus, don't go to the cross. Don't get hurt. I don't want you to hurt. Jesus went, get away from me, Satan. That's not you. He was able to discern. You see, God the Father, he breathed life into dust and said, I'm going to make man to be God-minded, Christ-minded. But then all of a sudden, he lost it. Turn to someone and tell him, Adam lost his mind. Genesis 3, verse 1-6. Now the snake was the most cunning animal that the Lord God had made. The snake asked the woman, did God really tell you not to eat the fruit from any tree in the garden? You see, that was her first mistake. She began to hear a different voice. And when you listen to the voice that is not the word of God, you begin to believe half-truth. Because it's true, but it's a half-truth. Verse 2, what does she say? We may eat the fruit of any tree in the garden, the woman answered, except the tree in the middle. God told us not to eat the fruit of the tree or even touch it. If we do, we die. So she knew. She had knowledge. The snake replied, that's not true. Twisting the truth. You will not die. God said that because he knows that when you eat it, you'll be like him and know what is good and what is bad. Human knowledge. Verse 6. When the woman saw how beautiful the tree was and how good its fruit was to be eaten, she thought how wonderful it would be to become wise. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, and he also ate it. Look at her thoughts. Her thoughts changed. Now, she wasn't discerning through nostrils. Now, she's judging by the eyes. Her way of thinking now is, what I see, I believe. Her way of thinking is, that looks like it's good. Here's the thing. The original text says, she saw that the fruit was good. But how many know there was two types of fruits? There was a good fruit and the bad fruit. We love to look at what's good. But we do not understand that it's tied to bad. You see, that fruit was produced by the same root. It was good and it was bad. It was bad and it was good. She chose to look at the good one. You ever hear this? I'm going to heaven because I'm good. You got to be a good Christian. Do good. Because if you do good, then you're saved. But then all of a sudden temptation comes around when nobody's around. And you see the other side of the tree. The tree of bad. And you begin to convince yourself, I'm good, but I'm not that good. Now we use these phrases, don't look at me. Look to Jesus, don't look at me. Who are you listening to? Paul said, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. Paul never said, hey, I'm preaching to you, but don't look at me. Who are they going to look at? The world needs to see Jesus. They're not going to see Jesus if every time we want them to see Jesus, we say, don't look at me. They have to see you. You're called the body of Christ for a reason. You see, she saw something. She said, It would sure be good to be wise. But wisdom only comes from God. Any other type of wisdom comes from your carnal mind. It's called knowledge. Paul said one day, I do not come to preach to you under human emotions or my human thoughts. He says, what I have seen, what I have heard, that is what I speak. To be Christ-minded is to understand that there is nothing good in me. Everything that is in me is not enough. I need Jesus. I need the other tree, the tree of life. Man heard a voice that wasn't God, and it brought confusion into his life. He said, maybe he's right. Maybe God doesn't want me to know everything. So I'm going to go ahead and try to learn everything on my own. I'm going to have my own revelation. I'm going to listen to people who I like to hear. I don't want to hear Pastor Jackie because all she does is confronts me. She tells me to live a holy life. I want to hear somebody that's going to motivate me. I don't want to come to church to be formed. I want to come to church to be pepped up. I want a cheerleader at the pulpit. I don't want a pastor. And what happens is we begin to build this certain type of faith that has no Bible base in it. So all of a sudden here comes a pandemic and we're afraid of dying. Because there is no Bible in us. And God is speaking, but we can't hear. Because we're trying to hear with our eyes. Hallelujah. We're trying to hear with our eyes the way we see. Everything becomes political in church. Well, I don't like that change. I don't like the way this choir sang today. They should have sang this other song. I liked it the way I used to like it. Because you're judging by your eyes. Why didn't Satan trick Adam? Why did he trick Eve? That's interesting. Why did he go to Eve? Genesis 2, verse 15 to 18. Then the Lord God placed man in the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and guard it. He told him. Say it with me. He told him. You may eat the fruit of any tree in the garden except the tree that gives knowledge of what is good and what is bad. God says, you must not eat the fruit of that tree. If you do, you would die the same day. I have a question for you. Was Eve there? She was not there. Who was there? Say it with me, Adam. Just Adam. It was just man and God, and God speaking to him. He says, look, I gave you an atmosphere to be productive. I put you in a place where you will have no lack, no sickness. You will not be tired. I put you in a place, I positioned you to be fruitful in everything you do. All I'm asking you to do is, look, you can eat everything, all of this. Just don't eat that. What's that called? Say it with me. Rema. Rema. What's Rema? You see, in the Bible, there's two ways of reading the Bible. One of them is called Logos. Logos is the inspired word of God. Everybody can read the Bible. But not everybody can hear God's voice through the word. You see, God spoke to Adam. Adam did not receive logos. Adam received rhema. It was a direct word from God into his life. Why did Satan go to Eve? Because she had Adam. Adam had a rhema word. And spoke inspired in that rhema word. And for Eve, it turned into logos. Somebody needs to say amen. And when she heard. When she heard an instruction from Adam. Who received an instruction from God. Adam received it differently. Because he was in contact, direct contact with the Father. Eve was not. She received it from Adam. So Satan went to Eve. Why did he go to Eve? She had no direction, no connection. The one who had the connection was Adam. So when I'm reading this, the Holy Spirit says, it's not enough to read the Bible. You cannot read the Bible and say, I'm Christ-minded. That's knowledge. That's logos. Is it good? Yes. Read your Bible. But I invite you to go to another level today. I invite you to understand that the only way you will be Christ-minded is not through reading the Bible. It's through having an experience with the God that gave you the Bible. Somebody needs to scream amen. I said somebody needs to shout amen. Turn to someone and tell them, are you ready to go deeper? Is this church ready to go deeper? Are you ready to hear the word that comes from heaven to speak into your life? Because you see, Satan is not afraid of people who know Bible. He'll sit down and read it with you. Then he'll twist it. And make you feel that what you believe is right. Come on, somebody. And he'll begin to tell you what the pastor is saying isn't right. You have the revelation. And he'll trick you into believing a lie. You need the Holy Spirit. Well, I know Bible, yeah. But do you know the God who gave the Bible to you? Satan is not afraid of a church that knows Bible. He's afraid of a church that can hear. Can somebody open this for me? See what you got me doing, shouting in here? I'm Mexican. Mexicans don't shout. Turn to someone and tell them, you need Rema. You need to be a Rema generation. Because what's coming, you're going to have to hear. If you don't hear, the world is going to say how the church has to be. And you're going to say, okay, that's fine. Let's close our church again. Let's just close it. Because they're telling us what to do. They are not God. Where God is taking this church is to be a Rema church. To hear. Jesus redeemed us from that carnal mind. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. Are you learning something? Dear brothers and sisters, when I was with you, I couldn't talk to you as I would to spiritual people. In other words, he's saying, you're not at my level to understand what I'm going to tell you. Simple. He says, I have to talk to you, though you belong to this world, or as though you were infants in Christ. In other words, Paul is saying, get it together. I'm trying to get you somewhere. But your problem is you're not maturing. And you're not maturing because your thoughts are mixed up with your emotions. And it's not letting you grow. When God spoke to the land, he said, produce. There was no emotion in it. He believed. Be careful when your faith is full of emotions. Because when your faith is full of emotions, today you're happy, tomorrow you're sad. Today you need everybody to pray over you. Tomorrow you don't even want to come to church. Why? Because you're full of emotion. Turn to someone and tell them, get out of your emotions. In today's church, all we do is preach emotions. We don't preach Bible. We don't preach to the spirit of man. We preach to the emotions of man. And if you don't come out feeling joyful, you say, church wasn't as good as it was last Sunday, because last Sunday I was jumping. I was shouting. It made me feel good. But you don't understand. We're preparing you to get out of your emotions and live in spirit. We're trying to get you to understand the difference between spirit-minded people and carnal-minded people. Spirit-minded people are people who live according to the word and mature into that Christ mind. Carnal-minded people always need a cheerleader. They always need a hug. They always need a call. They always need a visit. They are people who put their feelings above the truth of God. They are people who are afraid constantly of being alone. They don't trust God in the processes. They try to help God in the processes. It is God himself, when he's in you, he changes that area in your life so you can be Christ-minded. I like what Hebrews 8 verse 10 says. But this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel on that day. Say it with me, on that day. What day? That day. What does it say? I will put my laws in their minds. And I will write them in their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people on that day. Now let me explain what it means by that day. You see, before Jesus came, man struggled to carry the law. He tried so many times. God entrusted in man a law. And he quickly saw that man was unfaithful to his commandments. Man turned into this religious person. And he began to judge everybody else who didn't live according to the law. So now, years have passed, and here comes Jesus. And when Jesus comes, he speaks about the law, and he says, you have heard, hate your enemies. But I come to tell you, love your enemies. You have heard, an eye for an eye. You have heard, you've tried, but I came to realign you, to teach you that the law was never intended for you to hate. The law had the purpose to teach you the character of your Father. So when Jesus comes, he says, don't worry, I know you cannot carry the law. But I'm going to die on the cross. I'm going to do what you could never do. Hello, somebody. I'm going to do what you could never do, and pay attention to this. I'm going to die on the cross. I'm going to resurrect on the third day, and I'm going to be born again in your heart. On that day, hello, on that day, I'm going to make sure that the law is in your mind. I'm going to make sure that it's written in your heart. I'm going to make sure that every single morning you wake up, you think about God. You think about Jesus. You think about kingdom. Only on that day. This is where it gets interesting, because God says, I will make a new covenant with you. Because I know that the old covenant was not enough. So now he says in Romans 11, 26 and 27, and so all Israel will be saved, as the scripture said. The one who rescues will come from Jerusalem, and he will turn Israel away from ungodliness. And this is my covenant with them, that I will take them away from their sins. So now, how am I going to be Christ-minded? Please pay attention, because this is so important. The only way you could be Christ-minded is to surrender to the God who died for you on the cross. It's to understand that my way isn't the best way. It's to understand that I could probably think I'm intelligent. Maybe I feel that I'm smart. Turn to someone and tell them, you're not smart enough. One time, my teacher told me in school, you're so smart. I thought I was the smartest person there. But then I met this other guy that was smarter than me. And I realized quickly, I'm not the smartest person in the room. Then later on, I found out that if I am the smartest person in the room, I'm in the wrong room. How do you learn if you're the smartest person there? You need the Holy Spirit. Because he comes and renews your mind. He comes and teaches you. You don't know everything. And it's not that we're dumb. It's that we have realized that we need Jesus in our life. We realize that it's not enough what I know. I need to know more. I need to go deeper into his presence. I need to know him. I need to hear him. And when I walk in his presence, then I will know how he thinks. I will know how he reacts to something. We need the Holy Spirit. In closing, I want you to go to Romans chapter 8, verse 5 and 6. Turn to someone and tell them, you need the Holy Spirit. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your minds leads to death. But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. You see, the only one that can renew my mind is the Holy Spirit. I need him. He's the only one that can convict us of our sin. Acts 2, verse 37 and 38. Peter's words pierced their heart. And they said to him and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? I've heard about my sin. I've heard that I'm not enough. What do I do? Peter said, repent. Repent. Get out of your carnal mind. Change your mindset. We have to acknowledge that there is nothing good in us except Jesus. Romans 7, 21. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I eventually do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, he says. But there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person am I. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Verse 25, thank God. The answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. You see, Paul understood that there was a sinful nature in him. He understood that everything he wanted to do right always came out wrong. He understood that even if he tried to be a good Christian, in the end, he knew he was a sinful person. And it's not until we understand who we are today and we understand that we need the Holy Spirit to teach us who Jesus is. It's an urgency. Why? Because something great is going to happen for this church in the coming year. And God needs us to be focused. God needs us to be Christ-minded, kingdom-minded. Because if we are not set up in that position to think like this, we can lose the next generation. I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning. This morning, it's your fault. Tell them it's your fault. Why are you keeping the pastor up this early? I didn't get my beauty sleep. But the Lord gave me this verse for this house in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6, which is the verse that we just read. And the Lord told me these words. He says, until we are Christ-minded, we will always be religious-minded. And in this mindset, we are used to church the way we usually do it. But we do not come into the mindset of Christ understanding that it was never about a building. It was about a kingdom. It was never about your home. It was about a kingdom at home. God spoke to me at 4 o'clock in the morning and says, I'm going to raise up an Issachar generation in this house. And I began to study over Issachar. Issachar is the ninth son of Jacob. His wife Leah had this son. And I was speaking to Pastor Jackie about this earlier. And I told her, I woke up in the middle of a dream that I had about this home, this house. And in the middle of this house, I began to see a lot of babies being born. And they were coming out of the pews, they were running to the altar. I didn't understand much, but that's what I saw. When I woke up from the dream, the Holy Spirit began to speak into my life. And he says, tell this house, they're coming out of a cycle and going into a new season. A season of Issachar. Who is Issachar? Issachar, his symbol is a donkey. And it's really interesting about Issachar. I invite you to go home and read about it. Because Issachar is very original. He's the only tribe that fought with Deborah. Deborah needed help to fight against the enemy. And the other tribe said, no, that's a woman. We're not going to follow a woman. But Issachar's generation said, we'll fight with you. And they rose up and they fought and they won the battle. After that, you'll see them fight for David. They were the ones that helped David conquer the crown to be king. Turn to someone and tell them, God is going to raise up an Issachar generation in this house. It's a new mindset that's going to be growing in this house. Hallelujah. It's a new mindset. Issachar symbol is a donkey because he is called to serve. He is called to carry burdens. And God is saying to this house, I am going to birth a new thing in this house where the pastors will not be the only ones carrying burdens. God is going to call a new generation to say, I want to carry the burden of my pastors. But God says, I need you to be in the right mindset. The scripture says that Issachar's family, the Bible says they understood the times and the seasons. They were so wise. And I pray today that the Holy Spirit will wake up this generation. That when you guys celebrate next Sunday, that there will be such a powerful anointing in this place. That when the bishop begins to speak the word of God, it would confirm what today we are speaking right now. If you're going to grow, if you're going to go for the souls, you need to be Christ-minded. You cannot move in your emotions. You cannot say, I can't do this. Yes, you can. God called you into this new season. Somebody say amen. Can you lift up your hands and say, Lord, give me your mindset. Come on, could you just close your eyes just for a minute? And say, Lord, give me your mindset. I don't want to be carnal minded. I want to be Christ minded. And again, the Lord would say, I'm going to raise up an Issachar generation in this house. And they will go and they will understand the times. There's a new mindset that is going to be put in your heart today. I don't know who I'm speaking to, but God is taking confusion out of your mind. You have doubted that God is with you. And God is saying right now, I never left you. I've always been there. You just couldn't hear. And the Holy Spirit would say to some of you right now, I'm opening your ears to listen. Come on, somebody. I'm opening your ears to listen and to hear my voice. He's calling you right now. He's saying, I'm going to align your thoughts. Any confusion that you had right now, I'm going to invite you just to lift up your hands and say, Lord, I give you my mindset. I don't want to think the way I think. I want to walk in truth. I want to walk in Jesus. Holy Spirit, I pray right now for this church. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I pray for this church. I pray for every member. I pray, Father God, that your Holy Spirit will come over their lives. Right now. Right now. Every spirit of confusion leaves their mind, leaves their heart. Every spirit of fear leaves them right now. And I prophesy over this church, Christ's mind. I pray right now, Lord, as we were singing before, show yourself true to everyone. Let your Holy Spirit, Father, just take control of the way we think, the way we react. We give our heart to you right now. We give you our minds. Align our emotions to your word. Let us walk under the anointing of your spirit. Let this church grow. Let growth happen in this place. As you spoke to the land and the land produced, you speak into their lives now. And you speak the word produce. Produce. And I speak that word into their hearts. Let them multiply. Let them grow. Let every spirit of confusion leave this house. Let the Christ mind be set in their hearts through the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we pray for you. And I thank you, Lord. Amen. And amen. Can you give God a praise offering?